Now I'm going to get into website right now, and there is some more call tracking that's going to come up very quickly in the PowerPoint, or not call tracking, just tracking in general. But let's, because we have to get to follow-up. It's hard to know the sequence of things to educate you in, because it's all such a complete package, and I want you to have this panoramic view of the whole thing. So we'll get into your website now, because that's where you're going to have to capture most of your leads. I wish I had Sarah down here so I could ask her how many. Maybe Jessica knows. She's looking at me. Do you know how many leads we capture through the website every week? 600 or 700 leads. And the thing is, you know, we have a lot of competition. We monthly, so 700 times 4 is going to be, you know, 2,800 leads. And we have about 40,000 unique visitors, or I don't even know, something like 65,000 unique visitors. So it's a lot of work. That's a lot of unique visitors to only get 2,800 of them to give us their contact information, right? I mean, so you look at like what you have to do in order to create the influx that you want, that you think is enough for your business. The amount of communication that you have to put out there to get the amount you need to grow is significant. And this is the hardest thing for me to impart to business owners, because they think if they mail out 1,000 postcards or 5,000 postcards, they should have like a whole new business, because they just spent like $1,500. So where is the change in my business? And it just doesn't work that way. And I apologize. I wish it, you know, I feel sorry to have to give you the bad news. But it takes a lot of outflow to get the inflow that you need and want to convert. So when I say we have 65,000 unique visitors, we send out 180,000 postcards every single solitary week. We also spend $20,000 to $25,000 a week on pay-per-click advertising. That's the bulk of what we do. We do some PR stuff too. Good PR stuff that gets people interested, but that's not where the bulk of our leads are coming from. Even from organic, we do get a number of leads, but it's not anything like our pay-per-click, because it's just so much competition. And so it's that much to get that little bit. And that's just, you know, scale it back. Scale it back to what's real for you. But you're going to need to, like, if everybody here just said, okay, that's it, I'm going to do 10% a week of my, who here does minimum 10% of their revenue, their gross revenue, towards, okay, we have 1, 2, 3, towards a marketing budget, 4, 5, 6, 7. How's it going? Excellent? Good? Good? Yeah. It's like, if you're sitting here feeling like you're not getting enough from what you're doing marketing-wise, you're not doing enough to get what you need. And yes, you can always improve it and make it better and better, but it's quantity first. First, get that quantity up, and you will just see your numbers go up, like I did in the good old days when I switched from 2,500 pieces to 5,000, and I just watched it happen. Well, that doesn't work. We have to now, at this point, it doesn't work for me anymore, because I've now gotten the quantity to such a high level that now I need to tweak everything I'm doing constantly in order to make it more effective. So, as I said earlier, every marketing effort that you, every endeavor, you're leading people to your website. 95% of the people who are interested in your product or service are going, it used to be 95%, it used to be 85% when I first started doing this. It went up to 95%. I bet it's even higher than that. Nobody is going, there are people who will call right after going to your website, but most of, it's hard, our statistic on new callers, people who reach for the very first time via a phone, the stat goes like this over the years. No matter what we do, it goes like that. You know why? Because older people who pick up the phone are retiring, and younger people who can do everything from their cell phone are not calling. They're filling out a form. They're like, all right, I'm interested. I'll give you my... And fortunately for me, my chief marketing officer is the epitome of one of those people who won't pick up a phone. So she really understands, and she has to make the phones ring, so she really understands what it takes. But 95% of the people will go to your website before ever calling you. So the importance of what your website, the importance of how your website affects your postcard campaign, it's like they're so tied together. You can have the most amazing postcard in the world. When they get to that website, if it's not set up to capture leads, to raise the affinity, reality, and communication of the person visiting, they're not going to turn into a lead you can control. So here's, remember, you know, you can't even find a website that looks this bad anymore, this one. But there used to be a lot of websites like that. And, you know, you get this really snazzy thing that the marketing company did for the company. And then you go to their website and, like, their brother-in-law did it in 1992 or something. So it's really, you know, you've seen them. So the thing is about websites is that we have a certain, I mentioned this yesterday because it's true with all your marketing. We like familiarity. We want to go to a website where we know what to do when we get there. Because, like, if I can't find the menu bar, sometimes some of your sites that I looked at, I would go, where's the menu bar? How do I, and there's this new website, and we're using the same formula that's a little bit like, oh, it's new, but it's becoming familiar. It's the one where you have to scroll. The Growth Summit website is that way. You just have to scroll, and it, testing it out, it gets better conversion, so we're switching our regular homepage like that. But you have to make your website familiar enough to get somebody comfortable right away. So if they can't find your menu bar, if they can't find your contact information, it loses, you know, you're at that neutral stage, and then you'll, even if it's aesthetic, it'll go down a little bit. So the other thing, and I talked about this yesterday too, is the feeling that you get when you go to a website. This is a website we did for a friend of mine, actually, that we're making these, it's called Backroads Less Traveled, and they make these maps of these really interesting things that you can find if you're an RVer or if you're a camper or if you like to go on the back roads, and they're beautifully illustrated and you can't find it on a GPS, and you kind of have to get that feeling. You've got here the couple that created it. They're I don't know if some people might know, remember Dwight Metheny and Jeannie, and this was theirs, and it just they really just did it right in terms of the feeling you want to get when you go to a website for a particular product. Again, I talked about spas. The site has to be relaxing. The colors have to make you feel more relaxed. This is a pediatric dentist, really good client. That you have to make the parents think that it's going to be all about the kids when they get there. They do a really good job. Their postcards really match their website. Hey, honey bunny. Cynthia, my best friend, where is she? Back there. Look whose website I have in my PowerPoint. No. This is, he's not that old. This is my best friend, and this is her husband's website. He's an attorney, and you just have to have the right colors and the right feeling when you get to an attorney's website. So I want to go through, you know, just the things that every single website has to include, and then you'll be able to go take a look at yours and see how you feel about it after. You know, and sometimes I've had people come to this event and they went through the emotional harrowing experience, and I give them like my best advice. Like, I'm not going to, you know, hold back. I'm going to, you know, you want the truth, but they're just like not, they just not, they can't even confront it because it was just too miserable. So the thing is that so you just have to roll with it, kids. I don't know what to say. So here we go. Now, I'm using a website that is just very plain. It's not like a gorgeous website. It's not anything you're going to write home about. It's not going to win any awards. But it does capture leads, and it does have enough familiarity, because this is not about, like, you have to have the most gorgeous website. It's not about that. It doesn't have to be an award-winning Webby's website, you know. So what I like about this is the fact that it is fairly plain and ordinary and still does a good job. You've got this contact information. I mean, all we're talking about here is color that pops. This is a conservative type of a company. They do document retrieval. This is actually my husband's website. And even though it's a conservative business and he's dealing with big mortgage lending companies and title firms and all that kind of thing, it's still the color pops. Now, he's got the lead capture form, he doesn't have any of the, you know, I won't let him put the little asterisk in there. He has to do whatever I say, obviously. it's kind of like, you want me to do this for you for free? Yeah. Now, just because a website is pretty and it looks good and someone says, I'm a website developer and look at all the beautiful websites we've made, like this website looks perfectly pretty. You've got the nice smiles. You've got all the social media things. You've got the addresses. Click here to go to Google Maps. There's no fill-in form. There's no way to contact that person. You know, there's no way to get them to say, I always like for a dentist or a physical therapist or any kind of a doctor or any business where you think they're going to have questions, to have a prominent photo of the doctor or business owner and say, ask me any questions you like. I would be thrilled to answer. And there's their picture and there's a place for them to give their question and an email address. And be really willing to have that communication and respond to it. Now, I get a lot of communication, so I have some help getting responses. My assistant will sometimes write back when somebody wants to me to evaluate their website or their, but she sends it to me first before she sends it and I edit it, and a lot of times I have to change it completely because I disagree with what she came up with, but it sort of helps if you're super busy and someone knows your business and then you just kind of edit it if you feel like you're too busy to do that. But it really is a wonderful connection and a great way to get leads. Now here's another one. It looks great, but it's not optimized for marketing. You go here and you go, wow, this looks cool, it's a school, it's awesome, but there's no, I don't have a way to sign up. I don't have a way to talk to them or ask them a question that I have on the homepage. And you want, again, as I said, you want to have your contact information in the exact same place on every single solitary page. Because at some point, and if you have a website where they have to scroll, have more contact information, have it periodically throughout the page, so they don't have to scroll back up to the top. Now, I also say to consider using call tracking on your website because sometimes you want to see where, what page is somebody calling you from. So let's say you've got your Google Analytics and you see that people are spending 3, 4, 5 minutes on a couple of few different pages within your site. Put a few call tracking numbers, different ones. They're so inexpensive to get. It's not worth it not to do it because the calls are, you can actually see where they're calling from, you know, and then you can see how many people are calling you directly from your site. Kind of gives you a little bit more reality on what you need to do to fix the site. And if you're selling websites, I would make a package that includes several numbers for them because you know, it's easier for a business owner to decide if it's like, okay, this package is blah, and you get 3 call tracking numbers, and we'll move them around on your site as you see fit. I mean, they're going to call right when they see it, so it's an instant giveaway where they're calling from. You also want to have useful photos. Like, it's really hard, especially in my husband's industry, to have any pictures or anything because it's just paper. That it's just documents, and it's some of it's paper and some of it's electronic documents, but useful photos and definitely photos of you and your people. And not, it's okay to have some stock photos, but we're such savvy shoppers now. We know a stock photo when we see one. I don't even care if it's bad photography and not good lighting. If you see a real photo of a real business person, his team, what happens with your ARC? What happens with your affinity, reality, and communication? Your trust factor. You like them better. Suddenly they're there and they're real. All right. About you. My personally, and I will let me survey you. Who here, when you're about to do business with a local business, goes to the About Us page or the About the Owner page to learn about the business owner, to see if you're like them? There you go. I need a picture there. I want to see a photo of you. So many people, you think it's, oh, I'm not a model. I want to use a, I don't like my picture. I don't look good in picture. Get over it. People want to see the real you. You can definitely, my picture, if you go to Meet the Maniacs and you see that picture, does that look like me? No, it's gorgeous. I had the Photoshop, best photographer in the universe, and then Photoshop. Spend a few bucks. I mean, get a picture you like, you know. My husband still uses that on his screensaver on his phone. I'm like, baby, that doesn't look like me. It's ridiculous. But a picture of you is really important. Okay, let's talk about testimonials and reviews and ratings and reviews. We talked about social proof. You want to have your social proof listed right there on your website. And there's ways to figure out doing this. And I show you, I think I might show you my website where the social proof goes. I'm not sure on my slides. But, it used to be testimonials. And now, and you see here, it says testimonials. My husband is in a very old school type industry, and it's still testimonials, not even with a name. In his business, if he mentions a client's name, everybody goes crazy. It's so secretive, so he can't. But it's known in his industry, so it's okay. But you want to have the real whole name, and if it's a B2B, business to business, you want to have the business name. You want it to be as authentic as possible. But what's even better than having a testimonial is having a review. And what's even better than just all your 5-star reviews is having some of your bad reviews and then how you respond to them. So what we, and you can make it, people consider reviews extremely transparent, but you don't have to. People get afraid to just let people type whatever the hell they want. You get that 2% or the other 15% that are affected by the 2% that are angry and pissed and crazy all the time. And you don't want them typing. Well, let me ask you a question. If you go to you look at someone, they've got 4 stars or 3.5 stars, and they don't have that many reviews, and there's a 5, 5, 5, 1. And the 1 wrote like a thing like this and went off. What do you think about that reviewer? They seem like, okay, everybody, especially as a business owner, you know that somebody's going to screw up. Something happened. The truth of the matter is, how did that business handle it to make it better? It's 68,000 clients. Believe me, even with some of you, we've messed up. But how do we handle it, to make it so it's okay? And so we show all the, we don't have it go live instantly. We do receive it and then add it later with our response to all of them, the good ones, the bad ones, and the indifferent ones. And how do we get people to review them? We're very proactive about it, very proactive. Have you reviewed us? Has anybody here gotten a survey after their order is done? And we're asking you to please give us reviews and your feedback. A, we really do want to correct areas, and we're working on that constantly. To make it a smoother, experience for the client, and even if it doesn't seem like we're changing, we are. We're constantly trying, and that's also what's so great about your ratings and reviews and asking for comments, and then putting that up on your website just gives you so much credibility. It makes you really likable because you're willing to show the problems you have and how you fix them. Yeah. So here. You can get ratings and reviews here you can see how many we have here. And then you can actually take those reviews and things that people say, as I said, and put them right up on your website. And we used to have one place you had to go to look at all the ratings and reviews, but now we have them throughout the site. And that's another thing that we recommend, like put them throughout the site and get as many as you can. We're going to ask some of you to participate and give us some case studies. Definitely our couple with the camp, because they gave us such a nice result that they got. But putting those up on your website really adds credibility to your delivery of your product. Videos. You know that Google owns YouTube now, so if you want people to find you and they see a video, a lot of times it's a lot, a picture paints 1,000 words and a video paints like gazillion words. So it's very, very good to get listed that way. They like video, and there's a way to hook it with YouTube. I don't know how to do that technically. And a blog. Blogging keeps visitors coming back to your site. Blogging is one of those things. It's like, do I really have to do something else? I'm so busy. How am I going to do a blog now? You kind of have to have a blog. You want to become the opinion leader in your industry, in your area. And the best kind of, you write these articles, use them for your newsletter, repurpose them in your blog, and make them really educational. And, you know, you can go to Fiverr.com, F-I-V-E-R-R.com. Everything's $5. You could probably find a writer that you can test out for $5. And if you like them, they'll charge you more. But now you found them and tested them for $5 instead of like a few hundred dollars from Elancer, which is now probably called something else. What's Elancer called now? Upwork. So, you know, Fiverr is F-I-V-E-R-R.com. Upwork.com, you'll find freelancers. And constantcontent.com really does. Oh, we write content too, but you see, I'm not all about just selling what we do. I'm very happy for you to find it somewhere else as well. Just make sure they know how to write for SEO, okay?